Okay, last topic.
The draft goes well.
Yay.
Whoa.
Last time we talked about simple one-to-one variable relationships, right? And often we are interested in those things. But that would hype weight. Yeah. We talked about the, well, it's not technically regression, the idea of, you know, calculating somebody's salary.
If there's a simple formula.
So both, let's say it's not that simple. And straight line kind of thing. Yeah, let's say the correlation between two variables is 0.5. So if the correlation is 0.5, and we know the R equals the covariance divided by S sub X times S sub Y, like that's what it equals, right? How much variance is accounted for by one variable in another? The hardest part, by the way, of this last topic is you have to start thinking of variance as a thing. And that's not an entirely easy thing to do. It's counterintuitive in a way, okay? And I get that. But if we have two variables, they each have variance, okay? How much is the variance in one variable accounting for the variance in another? Think of a ridiculous example like height in centimeters or height in inches. It's exactly the same variance, right? Because they're both about height. They're just measured with different ruler. Okay? They share 1.0 or 100% of their variance. We have two variables that are correlated at 0.5, which for anybody here read a lot of social or personality psychology stuff, you know, 0.3, they love that stuff. That's when they get all excited about 0.30 as a correlation. 0.5, that's when we start to get things like IQ score and income. Okay? Which is, you know, and people get genuinely excited about that, psychologists. But you're not actually accounting for half the variance. R deals with standard deviations. When we talk about variance, we have to square it, right? So R in fact equals, or R squared equals 0.25. In other words, if we look at IQ score and income, which do correlate about 0.5, that says that your IQ is measuring a quarter of the same variance that your variance in, the variance in income. Okay? You think of them overlapping, where they share that variance. So variance, again, as I said, you have to think of variance as a thing, which is not an incredibly easy thing to do, because it's not something you're probably used to doing. That's the first deal. But secondly, you really have to think about this as two things can share variance. Okay? So you've accounted for 25% of the shared variance. And that's lots, it's a quarter. What about the other 75%? Right? What about the other 75% of variance that's left? There must be other variables that account for the rest of the variance. You might say to yourself, oh, well, it's just an error, individual differences. Actually, that's usually just a way of us saying that's stuff we don't know, and there must be other variables. So we have to think what these other variables might be. Okay. So what we do is we bring them into the model. We add extra predictor variables. Before, remember, we had y equals a plus bx. We're just going to have more x variables. We're going to have x1, x2, x3, etc. So that's what we're going to do. Now that's cool. So, here's the thing we're trying to predict, that's y. This is the variance in y. Okay? And then we have x1. This is the variance in x1. They overlap, that looks like about a quarter, actually, maybe a little less, but let's just pretend it's exactly a quarter. That means there's 75% left, or whatever percentage is left, on y there. Hey, look, another variable. Now we have another x variable, and it accounts for a different bit of y's variance.
We still have some left.
It's rare that you're going to come up with a model. It's called model building. It's rare that you're going to come up with a model that actually accounts for all the variance in y. It happens, but it tends to be very inconvenient. In psychology, it'll be perceptual or cognitive systems, things like that. Okay. It's not going to happen in something like IQ and something else. It just isn't going to happen. We had a model, me and a couple other guys had a model of animal timing that accounted for 99.8% of the variance.
That's like it was, of course, the other point, too.
So, okay, questions about this? Because I want you to understand those circles are the variance in y, the variance x1, the variance x2.
When you're saying y is 75%,
yeah,
right, and then x1 is 25,
yeah,
would you just say kind of split between x2 and x1 to make them both? And are you looking at them individually?
They're each accounting for, assuming this actually is overlap is 25%, they're each accounting for 25% of the variance in y. They are sharing
okay.
the variance.
Okay.
Yeah. Good question. Does this make sense so far? Because I know it's a little weird thinking of variance as a thing you can touch and hold. It's a very odd thing, actually. Oh, sorry, go ahead.
So they each overlap with 25% of the lines, but I know that they don't overlap with each other's variance.
Oh, this right now is what's called the best of all possible worlds.
Okay.
They almost always do overlap with each other.
Okay.
Yes, it's very good and prescient question. Because we will get there. But let's pretend that the world is working perfectly. And we're accounting for unique variants, which we almost never are. But yeah, that's a good question.
Yeah,
that's a good point. I mean, if this was income, why? And this was IQ points, and this was years of education, which also correlates with income, I think we'd probably agree that years of education is also going to overlap with IQ. Of course, your people with the IQs of around 70 don't go to a lot of schooling after a while. You know, they kind of stop. Right? They end up in New York. Sorry, I went to U of T, so we did New York jokes. It's okay. It's a joke. I won't say anything about anything here. Imagine what the joke is yourself, right? Your own material. So, the world really doesn't work this way, but let's pretend it does right now. Okay? All right. In general, now we have a model that looks like this. Y hat equals B sub 0 plus B sub 1 X sub 1 B 2 X 2 plus dot 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 plus B sub P minus 1 X sub P minus 1 plus E. So we're not saying A plus BX. A is the same as the B sub 0. This is the coefficient for the zeroth independent variable. In other words, or predictive variable. In fact, so it's not for a variable. It's where everything else equals zero. You have p minus one predictor variables. You have p terms. Because we have b sub zero, you have p terms, p minus one predictors. What is it, p minus 1? Because then you say they're p plus 1 predictors, or p predictors and p minus 1, sorry, p minus 1 predictors, p terms in the model. Okay? So you have p minus 1 predictor variables. It's not p, it's p minus 1. P for prediction. I actually don't know if that stands for that, but I like to remember it that way. Helps me. And this is actually for the data set. These are statistics, these are not parameters. Thinking back to analysis of variance, where we had, you know, x equals u plus alpha plus alpha beta plus epsilon, which you can probably all do that quickly now as well. Those are actually parameters, right? Because they're all Greek letters. Usually we think parameters, Greek letters are parameters. Latin letters are statistics. These are statistics. This is from our data set. This is actually what we get from our data set. So, So when we actually calculate this stuff, we get different numbers for B0, B1, B2, B(t-1). Okay. Madison, you got a question or are you just doing that?
No, that's
good. You're good? Okay. It's funny that I actually was able to see that from there, isn't it? It's in the population, this is, now these are parameters. Y equals β0 plus β1 x1 plus plus epsilon. You will, by the way, hear people call those b's, and in fact, a lot of statistics software calls them beta weights. They really shouldn't be called betas, they should be called b's, but it's become convention, so people call them beta. It's too bad, because they really should be called b's, but... Oh, by the way, this... These individual differences, that's what these are. The epsilons are normally distributed independent from each other with a mean of zero and a variance of sigma squared sub epsilon. Sound vaguely familiar? It's exactly the same assumption we have at ANOVA for epsilon, right? It literally is the same thing. And epsilon is not prediction error, whereas E in the model for a data set is prediction error. This is not prediction error. This is leftover variance, or what we like to call individual variance, or you know, individual differences. And all individual differences are things we can't measure. It's all they are. Things that aren't in the model, things that are left over, or as we call them in regression, residual. I always find it interesting that in statistics we tend to call things we don't measure or can't measure, that's just error. It's actually not error. It's stuff we haven't measured. But it's almost this hubris, right? Well, if I can't measure it, it must be some kind of mistake. It's an error. You're wrong. So epsilon is not prediction error, it's actually individual variation. So we can put in all kinds of different values for, and let's say we were doing a very simple one. So we had p minus 1 equaling 2. So we had some value that everyone gets, that's the this, plus something times your IQ, plus something times your years of education equals your income. And let's say it comes out and it says that with my IQ and my limited capabilities, by many years of education, we plug that into the formula and it comes out and it says I should make $89,000 a year. And I make more money than that. That's where the error comes in, the individual variation, because there's other stuff in there. My stick-to-itiveness and moxie. Oh God, I'm running out of things to say. It's the end of the term and I just have lost the will to live. Anyway, so you see that though? So that's extra stuff we haven't measured. My dashing persona, we haven't measured that, and that's also what's given me an extra X number of thousands of dollars. So that's, yeah, we gotta get a formula, right? Looks like this. And notice it's not what I have. This is actually saying the world works like this. This isn't a prediction, it's saying that Y, in our case, income, is a linear combination of these things. Okay? Question so far. Does this make sense so far? It's a little different than what we dealt with before. So again, it's why, not predicted why. You guys doing your own show over here? Is that what's going on? You passing around liquor or something?
And you went to
I'd like a drink. Beverage alcohol is my favorite flavor. Did you say there was ethanol? All right. Questions so far? You good with this? Is the laser hurting anybody's eye? No? Good. I want to look straight at it like an idiot. Because I'm stupid. So, what do we get? We get, if we have p minus 1, we get a line, because p minus 1 equals is x, is the number of x's, right? We get a line. Piece of paper. Now, if p minus 1 equals 2, we get a surface or a plane. So, we have now more dimensions, right? So, if my phone So if we've got just, there's y and there's x, there's the line. Now, if we've got another x variable, now we've got depth. A surface or a plane. And text messages, okay.
My daughter and my wife are talking about things they're buying.
His birthday. He's 17. Woke me up at 5 o'clock. Just kept looking in the
bedroom. Okay.
What the hell are you doing? My birthday.
I know, I'm well aware of it.
He's looking for presents. So I got up. I didn't have to get up. I didn't teach. I had a meeting with Brianna at 10:30 for academic advising. I could have slept in, but no. John wanted his presents at 6:15. I put it off to 7, and it's like, okay. Here's Rainbow Six Siege, and here's Blade Runner 2048, whatever it is. Blu-ray. He's happy with that. Anyway. Add him on Xbox Live, Jay Brodbeck. Kick your ass. Okay. By the way, there's nothing weirder than him saying in a headset over the internet, I'm going to kill you. It's really creepy. Funny mind, I don't know if he has another guy who lives in line, but Ken Herndon, we're really close friends, and Ken said he was, John was like 6 at the time, and Ken was over, and they're playing in 2 separate rooms, because we have lots of consoles, and they're playing Halo. He said, you know, there's nothing weirder than hearing an autistic kid say in your headphones, I'm going to kill you. And I saw Ken's character just hiding. He just had no idea what to do. It was great. Then at the end, he says, thanks for the medal. The people say, good manners. Doesn't rage quit nearly as often as he used to?
I still do.
So, that you got a plane. You guys learn about this. Do you ever do, Cartesian coordinates, X's and Y's? You did that, right? Did you do three-dimensional coordinates? X's, Y's, and Z's? Yeah, right? Now the Z, we don't call it a Z, we call it X2. Okay? Now the problem is what happens if you get, there you go. Two Gen's go right there. Yeah. It's like this. So there's Y, there's X, but then this would be a Z. It comes out like that. So you got a plane. Now, just because we can only think maybe 3 dimensions. We could do 4 dimensions. If p minus 1 is greater than 2, we get what's called a hyperplane in hyperspace.
Dude. Spin up the facet and let drive. Do your job. Fight the fracking toasters.
That was her life. Now, my stats prof had a way of imagining this, and he said that he could think of it as time. And then the plane starts moving. I can't do that. And then he said he could go one more and it would change color. It's like, I can't do that either. That's insane.
So you have an intuitive flaw for statistics program. You can't do that. You can't think in 4-5 dimensions. No, yet I can't. I'm a human. Maybe he was a fracking toaster.
So it's nice to imagine a line. In fact, if you draw a line, that's easy. You can imagine a surface. It takes a little longer if you've never played with three-dimensional coordinates before, but you can do it. Trying to imagine a hyperplane in hyperspace is probably a mistake. I've been trying to teach you all along to do things intuitively and get a feel for things. It's hard to do that with this. It's best to just imagine it as a freaking formula and nothing more. If you can think in 4 and 5 dimensions, go nuts. Way to go, you're great, but I can't do that. And most normal people can't. Maybe you're weird a little bit of a freak, and you can do that. A bit of a weirdo.
So maybe you can do it. If you can't, that's more opportunity. That's wonderful. But I can't.
We can find it if our regression model is significant. Have we explained the significance of the variance in the thing we're trying to predict? In Y, using analysis of variance. Because what's analysis of variance do? It says that we... Well, it's about variance, and it says significance. Oh, yeah. Well, why don't we use that? Yeah, ANOVA. Just when you thought it was safe to come out, it's ANOVA 2, the revenge.
3.
Yeah, that's right, I said. It's ANOVA 3 in 3D. Starring, who would be in the ANOVA movie? Who's somebody who doesn't ever turn down the script? I don't know.
Nicolas Cage.
Nicolas Cage. Yes, it would be Nicolas Cage.
That's pretty good.
Yes, it's definitely Nicolas Cage and the baby Michael Caine. Also, his internet stars. He's very old, but still.
Oh, you say she's a new vine.
Can't do Nicolas Cage.
So, we have two sources of variation. We have variance due to regression, in other words, the whole model, and residual. So all that stuff, and then E. And our question is all that other stuff, is that more variance, is that a significant amount of variance? So yeah, and you know, so I'm not gonna tell you how you calculate the sum of squares, no one does these by hand. But the degrees of freedom will be P minus one for regression, N minus P for residual, and little n minus one total. What's N in this case? It's the number of records. Okay, so if you think of this, if you were setting this up in SPSS, you would have the value for variable X1, the value for X2, the value for X3, whatever, and maybe your dependent variable. And if you had like 500 records, 500 lines, you have that 499 degrees of freedom. So P minus one predictors, little n minus P, that's the residual. And then we would take mean squared regression, divide by mean squared residual, and we'd see if we get a significant F. We bloody well better get a significant F. We've got all those variables there, they better explain a significant amount of variance. If they don't, you don't know what you're doing. You're not gonna pick numbers, sort of variables that wouldn't work. Remember, we're building a model here. This is a different kind of thing than we do with an experiment, per se, necessarily. So, one thing that's the sum of its parts, in other words, all of the stuff together, B sub 0, B sub 1, B sub 2, B sub 3, all those things together, they pretty well better be significant, right? It's not about the individual variables. It's not about X1 or X2 or X3 or whatever. It's about the whole model. Of course it's going to be significant. It's always significant. So if we had, again, we're predicting people's income, and we had their years of education, their IQ, or what's something else that would correlate with your income? That we can measure, by the way. Don't say something else, but don't say something ridiculous. What's something we can measure? Happiness? Yeah, that's true. That's nice. Okay, so that's good. What's something else? It would correlate with your income.
Socioeconomic status.
Yeah, that kind of is your income.
Your parents.
Yeah. Your parents' income. That's probably true. Okay, that's four that we know would calculate. That's going to be a lot of the variance. Probably quite a bit of the variance. Okay, let's throw in something else. How long your middle finger on your left hand is, and how about how much saliva you produce when a cracker's put in your mouth, and oh, I don't know, how tall you are measured in pennies. You stack pennies up, see how tall you are. Now, none of those probably, the height one might, probably correlate too highly with your income. They hardly explain any of the variance. But if we had those in our model, would you then say, oh, there's a number of pennies that taller you are.
How many pennies taller are you, son? It
sounds like something an old person would say.
Hey, sonny, how many pennies tall are you? Well, when I was young, we used to say you were three nickels.
I don't know. Anyway, the hell I'm even doing it. Again, I don't know what I'm doing at this point. I've lost everything. But those variables are ridiculous, but if they were in our model, we would say, that's significant! So, it's about the whole model. We know the ones we wouldn't care about, the ones we would care about. We had four reasonable ones and three ridiculous ones.
How many pennies tall are you, sonny?
I'm going to start saying that to people, and I don't know what that, by the time I'm really old, I know you a lot of you think I am, I'm only 52, but when I'm old, I want that to spread around. About old people. And then that and my other, kind of thing I'm trying to get back. Not this one's an old, I made that, we just made that pennies tall one up. But the other one I want to get back into the vernacular. I want people to start calling marijuana grass again. going to be legal soon, and, you know, because I watch Mad Men a lot, like always, and they're always talking about smoking grass, and it's like, oh, the 60s were great. Let's all start growing grass.
You said it, don't worry.
Yeah, I'm going to start, I want that spreading around. So we need a finer grain analysis. I mean, pennies tall. I don't know where the hell I get these things. You don't want to be in here. It's not good. So we'd actually, the model's going to be significant. It's just going to be. But we want to be concerned with how much extra variation we've accounted for by adding another variable into the model. So we started that with income and IQ, right? So now we want to care about how much extra variance in Y is accounted for by bringing in, what was the next one? It was years of education. How much extra variance is accounted for by that? That's the question. That's the interesting question we're asking. And that's called R squared, which is sum of squares regression, or sum of squares total. Okay? That's how much the total model, all the overlaps with Y, divided by what's left, but by the total amount, rather, of Y. Okay? So if I was to draw that on the board, where's a good place? Over here, I guess, eh? Yeah. So here we have Y. That's the variance in Y. And here's X1. And here's X2. And here's X3. It's all of the shaded areas I'm doing here divided by Y. So it's good. So that's going to give you a proportion of the variance in Y accounted for by the whole model. But the thing we really care about is when we add X4 in, so we're shooting that different direction, how much extra variance are we accounting for? And you can probably guess the question we're really asking is it enough that we care? Because almost everything has a small correlation with everything else, but does it matter? The length of your middle finger on your left hand, well, that probably does somehow correlate with your income. You know why? Because taller people make more money than shorter people. It's not a huge thing, but it's a thing. Right? And you probably, taller you are, the bigger your middle finger is. I really honestly was not meaning to give you, because I never do it with the left hand. I would never do that.
What about Dan DeVito?
What about what?
Dan DeVito.
See? I said correlation, I didn't say causation. But also, I mean, as a rule, we like taller people. We all do. It's a weird thing, it's stupid, and there's probably an evolutionary explanation for it. Right? But the correlation is so small that it doesn't probably matter either. It's probably a very tiny amount of variance. Right? So if we did read, it's probably like little thing here. Does that even matter? Probably not. Probably not. Is it real? Sure, fine, it's real, but who gives a shit? Like, it doesn't matter. It's so little extra variance that we don't care. So what we're going to care about is any change in our square, we bring in another variable into the model. So when we add a variable, let's say you have 5x variables, which we have here. When you add a sixth variable, does r squared go up? It must. It can't go down. It could stay at zero, or it could be exactly the same, but that means there's literally no overlap between that sixth variable and Y. And the chance of that actually happening is almost zero. It's almost nil. But does it matter, is the question. Right? The question is, by how much does R squared go up, big R squared? We've lost a degree of freedom. Every time we add, remember, another predictor variable, we've lost degrees of freedom. We want as many degrees of freedom as we can get. Degrees of freedom will make us happy. We've also got increased complexity to a model. If we go from a line to a plane, or a surface, whatever you want to call it, that's okay. right? Most of us can deal with that. It's a little hard to imagine, but you could actually, any decent graphing program will print you a 3D graph, right? So that's totally doable. No problem. If you go from a surface that I can print out to a hyperplane in hyperspace, that's when you gotta make a judgment call. You say, now I can't actually draw this for anybody. I can write out an equation, but that's a big step I just took. I can't print it out and show people, see, this is what it looks like. I now have to say, yeah, here's an equation. So that's usually a big step. And whenever we get extra complexity, things get harder to understand. Every time you add an extra variable, it's a little harder to understand. So we need something other than big R squared to look at to determine if we should add another variable. This is something called adjusted R squared. Don't worry, I'm not going to ask you to reproduce this on a quiz or something. And if it was on the final exam, hey, look, it's written right there. Copy it out. Big R squared is n minus 1 divided by n minus p times sum of squared error divided by sum of squares total. Cool. So in fact, what that does is it's weighting it. Adjusted R squared can go up and down. That's nice. So it's weighted by the number of variables in the model. It actually can go down when more variables are added. We want something that can go down and go up. So we want something that can go down and go up. Something we can look at and say, okay, we added that next variable in and adjusted our squared, actually went down. That's not good. Not good. So what we have then is we are making a lot more judgment calls in regression model building than we would ever do in something like analysis variance. Because I can say, how much does R squared have to go up to keep a variable in the model? And you know what your answer is? Enough. And that's, it's somewhat subjective. It's not like F-test where you go, 0.05, done, good. So here's an example. We have, here's a regression model. It's not really a model. I'm just saying this is with only x1. It's y equals some. And when I say it's a y equals x1 model, I mean it's y equals the intercept plus b1x1 plus error. But I'm just using a shorthand saying it's just x1. So only x1 is in the model. So put that one over there. And this one is with x, only x2 is in the model. Only x2, no other things. And as you know, we could go with x1 and x2. So we have y equals the intercept plus b1x1 plus b2x2. Plus error. That would be that one. Remember what the sum of squares are? They're measures of variation. Not variance per se, but variation. Just a somewhat different term. Which one do you think there is the best model? Which one would you say I would be confident, I would like to tell people that that's the good one? So we have two one-variable models and a two-variable model. And that's all we've measured, so we don't have any three-variable models lying around. There's no X3 lying around. Let's go the other way. Which is the worst model? Which one would you go out and want to use that one? Joe?
X2 is the worst one?
Yeah, I think X2 is the worst one. Why?
Your S3 is really small.
This is 30 out of 130. Remember how you calculate R squared? It's sum of squares regression over sum of squares total. Sum of squares total is 130. 30 divided by 130. What is that, about 22? 22, something like that? see.
So 30, blah, 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 30, 23, sorry. So your R squared is 0.23. Over here, did anybody follow so far what I did? I just took regression, sum of squares for regression, go to my sum of squares total, which is this plus this. So let's say, go away. I am giving you the finger. Okay. This one here, what do we have? We have 50 out of 130. That's good. 50 out of 130 is 58.58. Is that right? It can't be that high. 0.38. Okay. Not bad. Yeah, I screwed up the arithmetic. But I think Curtis has a point. X1, X2 is 80 out of 130. 8/13. But Curtis, we added an extra level of complexity here. These are lines, and that's a surface. Would you be confident? Like, I'd be okay. I think I'd be okay with it, but. Right? Because you can draw it out.
You could, that's what I was going to say. You can draw it out because it's simple.
It's printable. You could, I couldn't draw a 3D picture, but I know a printer can, so I'm happy.
It's not high interface.
No, exactly. So we're not going up to a three-variable model, right? And going back to Joey's question, the very beginning of the class, do X1 and X2 overlap? In other words, are they explaining any of the same variance in Y? Look at that. Are X1 and X2 explaining the same variance in Y or unique variance?
Unique variance.
And how did you come to that conclusion? Because you're right, it's unique. Now, how did you come to that conclusion or are you guessing?
I didn't guess. I just based on the fact that REG for the value of 50 there adds to the value of 30 and makes 80.
If the sum of squares regression for x1, x2 was less than 80, they must overlap sum of x1, x2. But in this case, they don't.
The world never works like this, but this is an example I cooked up.
So, 50 and 30 is 80. Oh, wow. In fact, I like that. Hell, if there's no overlap, if I found two literally mutually exclusive variables, oh, baby, they're both going in the model. Right? So instead of thinking of it like Venn diagrams, the other way you can look at it is you can think of the variance in Y being like a big container. Okay? So this whole thing is Y. Now we'll add X1 in. And it fills up the container that much. Now, we know that if it was separate, okay, that is Y. And we say, let's say that X2 is this. I should make actually the same things, right? So X2 is less, okay. Okay, so that's X2. If this just goes on top of this, it's unique variance. On the other hand, what could happen, what if X1 and X2 overlap some? Then it's going to be a little bit lower. And then we have overlap, which is actually the way the universe really works. Unless you've designed an experiment to work a different way. There are times when you can make it. Contrive the world to work a certain way, and that's usually the clever stuff that goes on. We're not usually talking about experiments or regression models. Usually we're talking about larger data sets, and we're trying to make these predictions. X1, X2, X1. Do you have questions so far? Do you want to keep going, or do you want like a couple more slides, or do you want to stop and process this? I'm okay either way. We're well in time. I have no problem.
Hyperspace.
What's that?
Hyperspace.
Hyperspace. Already thinking about that's a little bit much, but you want to go one more? One more slide. So we can calculate sums of squares. Remember I talked about with empty cells and all that stuff, how there's type 1, type 2, type 3, and type 4 times the sums of squares? Type 2 sums of squares are actually really only useful for regression. Type 1 sums of squares depend upon the order something goes into a model. So if we put x1 in first, things are going to be different than if we put x2 in first. Because of the overlap, right? And the unique variance it's accounted for isn't anything more unique, okay? Type 2 sums of squares don't care. They're called conditional sums of squares, and what they do is they say, with this already in the model, how much extra? That's the interesting question. We want to know how much extra. We don't really care about the whole model. We care about how much extra. So let's say if we have three variable model, x1, x2, x3. This has to be two slides. So we have x1, x2, x3. Yeah, I can't stop here. It'd be ridiculous to stop here and then 5 days later come back. So we have three variables and a y, obviously. The type 1 sum of squares for x1 is sum of squares regression for x1. And that's it in the model. Now the type 2 sum of squares for x2 is actually the sum of squares regression for x1 and x2. It's just how they calculate. The type 1 sum of squares for x3 is sum of squares regression for x1, x2, x3. All that whole model. And you can see that that's not going to be incredibly useful. What's going to be nice and useful is the type 2 sums of squares. Sum of squares regression for x1 given x2 and x3 are already in the model. Sum of squares regression for x2 given x1 and x3 are already in the model. Sum of squares regression for x3 given x1 and x2 are already in the model. So type 2 sums of squares account for unique variance only. So they're very useful in us determining, does it make sense to put this in the model or not? Oh, Joe, yes.
Would we ever be doing this by hand?
Oh, hell no. No one does these things by hand. You can get... when I was in grad school, we would get these printouts, and it would tell us type 1 sums of squares for x1 and x1, x2, and they'd be x1, x2, x3, and then the question would be, what are the type 2 sums of squares for this? And you actually can calculate that if you know, but it's annoying. No one does that. The important thing is, if you had a printout in front of you, you usually have to ask statistical software for type 2 sums of squares. It'll just give you type 1s, and it's like, they're not really that useful, because they're about the whole model. What I'd like to see, if I was making a decision, should I have a variable in the model or not, I want to see type 2s. And that's usually an extra option you have to click. So you have to click and say, okay, I want to see the unique variance accounted for by x1, by x2, and by x3, given the other two variables are in the model. I wouldn't do that. Put it this way, on the final exam, you're probably going to be given some stuff in front of you that's going to say, the question will be like, what's the best model and why? So you'll be numbers there, but I wouldn't make it count. Question. You looked at the half other image. Okay, good.
I can't remember if you've already told us.
Okay.
Will the final exam be open to public?
Of course.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Are we going to no computers, right? So we're not going to be doing any SPS?
Oh, God, no. I'm not going to be. Look, the course is about statistics. SPSS is like a tool. That'd be like saying, in a creative writing class, make sure you use Microsoft Word. It's the tool. You know, or you have to use a certain type of pencil. That's ridiculous. I wouldn't do that.
Thank you.
I could give you a printout, perhaps, and say interpret it, but it would have all the information on it. That's all. So, yeah. All right. We will stop there and continue on this stuff on Tuesday. Thank you, everybody.
Previously on multiple regression.
So I was talking about these different kinds of sums of squares last time, type 1 and type 2. The important thing is, if we're just looking for extra variation accounted for, we're going to use type 2s. Type 1s allow us to actually calculate type 2s if we're doing that. Okay? So when we're looking at a given variable, we're just going to look at the type 2 sums of squares. And you'll see the kind of things I'm going to talk about today are going to look just at those. So why should you care about that? And I mentioned this, I think, last time. If there's no correlation between the variables, type 1s equal type 2s. If there's a correlation, type 1s don't equal type 2s. That's really, so it's a diagnostic tool we use when you're determining what variables to leave in the model, which ones to drop out. A little bit more on that later. So what can type 2s give you? This is the thing, right? Like, why would you care? What kind of information they're giving you. Type 2s give you the extra variation accounted for by having a variable in the model given the other ones are already there. So they're talking purely about extra variance accounted for, which is what you want to do. If you're going to put a new term in the model, you want to make sure that that new term is explaining a lot of variance. Right? So you want to be sure that new term is explaining quite a bit of variance. This gives us something we call coefficient of partial determination, which is just a measure of this, a standardized measure of extra variance accounted for when adding a new variable to a model. You ever heard of a partial correlation? Okay. This is when you do a regular Pearson correlation and then you have other things statistically controlled for. It's the square root of the coefficient of partial determination. So the big R squared is the coefficient of multiple determination. It's telling you about the whole model. Just R is telling you about the coefficient of partial determination is telling you just the extra variation accounted for by adding a new variable in the model. Okay? All right. So the coefficient of partial determination is extra variance accounted for by adding this extra variable. So how much extra variation y are we explaining by adding an extra variable? Because what we're trying to do is explain variance in y with some linear combination of some numbers times values for the x variance. I've now had 5 slides in a row that said almost exactly the same thing. I'm trying to get this home to you. What it's doing, what these type 2 sums of squares, which we use to calculate the coefficient of partial determination, what it's doing is just telling us when we add another variable in, is it worth our while to leave it in? Is it accounting for enough variance? Okay? So I may have gone through those slides quickly, but they all say almost exactly the same thing with different words. So you square that, you get a partial correlation, which I talked about. It's pretty useful. Or square root of it, actually, I should say. Yeah. So take the square root of that square. Okay. As again, I also mentioned. So why does this matter? Again, think about the model. The model says y hat equals b sub 0 plus b sub 1 x sub 1 b sub 2 x sub 2 plus dot b sub b minus 1 x sub b minus 1 plus e. That's what our model generally says. The question is how many, what does p minus 1 equal? How many variables are we going to have in our model? There's nothing in there, by the way, about two variables acting together. There's nothing in there saying that. Oh, plus the overlap of these two. It's the amount a variance accounted for by the individual variables on their own. There's nothing in there about overlapping of variables. There's no plus B3 times X1, X2. There's nothing like that. Right? It's all single variables. It's a, what's called, it's first order, right? It's not like you're squaring anything. It's not like you're multiplying anything. We just have some coefficient, the betas, the b's, times whatever the value of x is. It's not, if the value of x is 7, then everything changes. It doesn't say that, or whatever the number would be. So there's nothing in there but two variables together. So, in other words, we've got to make sure we're accounting for unique variants. And when we don't have unique variants accounted for, in other words, when we have overlap of predictor variables, we have some problem, because it's not in the model, and that problem is called multicollinearity. So it's got a name, but I'm not going to commit to nominal fallacy by saying I've explained it, by just giving it a name. So it has the name multicollinearity, and that is a problem because there's nothing in the model about overlap of variables, about two things happening together. There's nothing in there like that. It's all linear combinations of coefficients times the x's, the levels of the x's, okay? Questions about that? Does that make sense, right? Because there's nothing there that says x1 times x2, or whatever. It's just x1, x2, x3, yada, 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 x of t minus 1. There's nothing in there about overlap. So where's any overlap variance going to go? To E, error. And we don't like error. We want that to be small. Right? We want that to be small. Okay, questions so far? So what you're doing if you actually have multicollinearity is you're violating an assumption. And we all know that violating an assumption is a bad thing because it makes error bigger. It'll change the b's. So it'll make the predictions, the values you multiply times each x variable, it'll change them and make them inaccurate. So you might think, well, how in the hell we better make sure we don't have any multicollinearity? And you're always going to have some. You just don't want to have very much. But think about the absurd example. We wouldn't put a variable in height in centimeters and height in inches because they're accounting for exactly the same variance. That'd be ridiculous, right? So we have to have a way to detect multicollinearity. Well, the first thing you could do is just look at the correlations between the variables. You could do a Pearson correlation, a correlation matrix. That's easy to do. Any spreadsheet program would ever. And take a look at the x variables and say, oh, do these correlate or are they not correlate? They're all going to correlate some, by the way. It's exceedingly unlikely that they're not going to correlate at all. Exceedingly unlikely. But you don't want to look at them and say, oh, look, x1 and x3 correlate more than either of them correlate with y. Well, you probably want to throw one of those out and not use it. So you might chuck a variable, which feels bad, too, because you've collected all these data, and, I mean, you might have hundreds of records and maybe 20 or 30 variables, and you say, oh, I thought that was a great variable. That's got to go. So it's, you got to do what the numbers tell you to do. You can't go with your gut. So you're probably going to have to get rid of something.
All right.
Questions so far? So all this is just, those last like 10 slides are all about the same thing. We want to look for unique variants, and when we don't have it, we don't want that variable in the model. That's another assumption. We assume a linear model, in other words, this plus this, this plus this, with a a line that is expressed just as a straight line with a plane. It's a straight line and then another straight line, maybe like a surface, like a piece of paper. With a hyperplane, you can't imagine it, but it's basically saying everything has to be single things added together. There's no multiplication. There's no weird kind of bumps in the middle. So what if your relationship isn't linear? And this happens a lot. We can think of a lot of things in psychology that aren't linear. Forgetting curves aren't linear. You do most of your forgetting in the first few minutes, and then it goes to asymptote, right? You think of reaction times, doing a task, and you get fatigued, and your reaction time goes up and up and up and up and up. And then it steadies off. So you can think a lot of those cases, we have like exponential curves. We talked the other day with the Yerkes Dodson law, and you've heard about that before, right? The best amount of arousal to do a task, it's somewhere in the middle, and that's a parabola, it's an upside down parabola. And if you remember your grade 10 math, an upside down parabola is a second order equation, right? It's y equals something, something x squared. Well, that's not linear. That's not a straight line. So we're going to do something about that. Oh my God, what's that? Y equals lambda sub 0 plus lambda sub 1 x times e. All that's saying is that this is a exponential equation. It's an exponential line. You know what an exponential curve is? It goes way up very fast. It's got an exponent in it. That's all that is. It's an exponent. Okay? You'd be concerned if we're... Yep, exactly. When you actually hear about it, but it's not straight. It's like...
Okay, that. I was going to say, is that not linear?
No, because it's like something like this.
Okay.
Yeah. Reaction times do that all the time. Right? If you went to the thesis conference, right, and you heard Samantha Brown, one of my students, speak about her task, and she didn't say this in her talk because it was a general audience, but she was using reaction times, and she fixed them. Because reaction times, that doesn't look right. It's not a straight line. We want nice things where the variance is the same all the way through, all that stuff. You remember how to fix those kind of things? You take the logarithm. So you might scream, but it actually turns into a beautiful, if you take the logarithm on both sides, hey, look, it's a linear, we can turn it into a linear equation.
Beautiful.
Because if you've got log in front of every term, you can then drop your logs, which of course, when I was like grade 10 math and learned that, we'd all go, because we were idiots. But I see some of you giggling right now, so maybe we're all idiots. But pretty easy. Back down, we just turn something that isn't linear into something linear. That's pretty cool. That's pretty neat. It's called an intrinsically linear regression model. It's intrinsically linear. It can be made linear with a simple mathematical transformation. Okay. We can do that with a parabola, right? We can do that with an exponential function. We can do that with a logarithmic function. We can turn them into straight lines. All you're doing is same as the transformations we talked about early on in the course. You're just turning, you're changing the units. So it's totally doable. Not everything is intrinsically linear. Okay, so just because you might see, let's say you decide you're doing thesis research next year or something that you want to do, that you do something and you look at the data, you want to do a regression model, and you look and you say, that's all over the place. There's no straight lines. Those aren't straight lines. Well, I can turn it into a straight line. No, you may not be able to. It may actually be that it's just not straight, it's not intrinsically linear. It's not something we can transform. It's not always the case that we can simply turn one variable into another kind of variable that's a straight line. You might be able to, though. Go find somebody who knows a lot of math. That's what you do. And you say, can you look at this scatter plot and tell me what kind of function you think that is? And if they look at it and go, oh, it's a third order quadratic. You go, I don't know what that means. Come talk to me and we can fix it. That's easy. As long as you can recognize the pattern, you can turn it into something into a straight line. But it isn't always the case that it works like that. Okay? So we're assuming also an additive model. That's this plus this plus this plus this. Right? There's no mention of interactions at all. There's no like. Remember, we had never heard of y x equals mu plus alpha plus beta plus alpha beta plus epsilon. There's no alpha beta. There's no multiplicative terms. I think you can put in x1 times x2, I guess. You can do that. That's not something that's forbidden. It's tough to know what the term should be, though. Is it x1 times x2? Is it x2 times x3? Is it x1 times x2 times x? It's hard to know. Exploratory data analysis can be helpful here. Past research can be helpful here. But typically, people don't do this. It can be done. It's just not something people typically do. You're trying to come up with a simple additive model. And then you said, simple additive model up until this term that's you've got the third derivative in it. You don't do that. Okay. You can do it. It's just not done very often. Usually you're going to do this if you've actually designed an experiment, if you're looking at an experiment and you know there's an interaction. So you could analyze everything we've talked about analysis of variance, you could do it with regression. I can tell you, in fact, that you may have noticed this when you print out an SPSS printout. One, it says intercept is the first thing. It's because it's done the regression. I'm sorry, it's done the ANOVA with regression. And it actually has assumed an interaction parameter, like a term in the model. So it can be done. It just isn't typical. So it all comes down to, how do we select the predictors? How do we select our x variables that we're going to put in our model? Can you have qualitative ones? One of the beautiful things about something like ANOVA is that you can say, I can have male, female, and I can have biology student, psychology student, sociology student. That's easy. I can do that. We can get an interaction. You probably saw some stuff like that on Friday at the thesis conference. You can look at that. It makes sense of it. The thing is, this thing's about numbers. It's about an equation. So like if the model said, let's say B1 was major, and we have three of them. How are we going to do that? Like, how's the math going to come out? It's like 6 times major, and major can be biology, psychology, or sociology. You can't multiply times 3 sociologies. What does that even mean? So qualitative variables are tough to use. You typically don't use qualitative variables. You can if they're binary. Okay, so you might say sex, binary. Okay, I don't want to get into a discussion. Okay, vast majority of people identify as male or female. Okay, and we would say, well, if it's other, we're just not going to use that. That's fine. Okay, try to exclude anybody. Statistics, of course. So you use 0 or 1. Yeah.
So you're using 1. Qualitative, just it depending on what group you're looking at.
Yeah, exactly. So if I say zero is male and 1 is female, then for sex, yeah. Then I just say, oh, I see, it's a measure of femaleness. Yeah. You're either not one or you are one.
Can you say that psych is 1 and bio is 2?
No, because it's biology twice the major that psychology is.
Gotcha.
Right? But there is a way to fix that. It's really annoying, but there's a way to do it. So it's all, you can't use 1 and 2, you gotta use 0 and 1, because remember, it's quantity of something. So if it's 0 for female, for male, and 1 for female, we're saying it's actually a measure of femaleness. Okay? You have none or you have some? Okay? So that's what we're saying there. On the other hand, because how are we gonna do something with 3 different possibilities?
three different possibilities. So, biology, psychology, sociology.
How would you do that? Any ideas? Tough, right? Well, instead of, we can't use 0, 1, and 2. You might think that's like, no, that's not going to work either. So sociology 0, psychology 1, biology 2. That doesn't make any sense. Because remember, at the end we get an equation. So what are we going to do? Well, there's actually a way to do this. And the way you do it is something called dummy coding. So, and again, here we have to say we can't have double majors, we couldn't have, so it happened to be just a psychology major, biology major, sociology major. So we have a variable called psych. And a psychology student gets a 1 in it. And then we have a variable called biology, and they get a 0 in biology, and a sociology, they get a 0. So we actually have to set up 3 new variables. It's really annoying. And then we say, okay, how do we code a biology student? 0, 1, 0. How do we code a sociology student? 0, 0, 1. Make sense? So dummy coding allows you to code qualitative variables. As you can see here, if you've got like 5 different levels of qualitative variable, now we suddenly have 5 new variables. What a nightmarish hell. What kind of, I don't want that. But it's the only way to do it. It's the only way we can fix this. Hey, you look like you want to ask a question.
I want to make sure, this is probably like,
that's fine.
You're probably thinking like, why are you even opening your mouth? But are we looking at this in like a column?
Yeah. So this is like, each of these are your record. So this is everybody in this room, because you're all psych majors.
Yeah.
Because I looked before class just to make sure, because no one takes this course for fun. Twice in my career. One math student and one biology student. So here we go. We can code, so then we got it. Right, so we said 1 is a female. So this is good. This is Brianna right here. 1, 1, 0, 0. And then what's, I don't know, whatever the hell else we were measuring.
Okay.
And now let's pretend there is that, the biology student that I had a few years ago, a guy named Mike Kendall. So Mike Kendall, pretty obvious that his score on this is going to be 0, 0, 1, 0. I've never had a sociology student in this class, so I can't figure an example. But let's say it was a woman sociology student in this class. She'd be 1, 0, 0, 1. Now I can, because mathematically it makes some sense. It's like, oh, are you a psychology student? So it's a measure of psychology studentness. You either are one or you're not one. It's annoying as hell to do this, by the way, but it's the only way you can put this into a regression model. Make sense?
Yeah.
It's kind of neat, right? It's a clever idea. So you think here you've collected two variables, sex and major. You've actually collected 4 according to your regression. And then let's say we have one person who's one person who's a political science major, just 1 in your whole data set. Oh, suddenly you have an extra variable. It's really annoying to do this, but I'd actually just throw that in rather than make up another variable. You have to really be careful too at Likert scales. We love Likert scales, don't we? Right? On a scale of 1 to 7, 1 being strongly disagree, 7 being strongly agree, and that sounds very mathy. It's not. If I score 7, like if it says, what's a good item on a personality type questionnaire? I don't know. I've done a personality course since 1985.
Extroversion?
No, but give me an item. I like being the center of attention. Mm-hmm. Right? That'd be extroversion? Okay, that would help you understand, I would imagine. So 1, we strongly disagree. 7, we strongly agree. So I pick 6.
Right. That's six. In group people I know. People I don't know, it's like minus 40. The guys must sit in the corner. I don't want to meet any new people. I don't want to know any new people. I'm 52 years old. I don't need any more friends. Totally fine. But people I know, I like that. It's fun. I was actually last night with a friend of mine from high school that I hadn't seen in like 30 years. And she was just in town for the night and messaged me on Facebook, hey, I'm here, so visit her. And I said, no, my superpower is the ability to turn virtually anything into something about me. And she laughed. She said, yeah, I've known you since you were 14. I'm well aware of that. So I scored six in this. Now, let's somebody here who's more introverted? I don't know. We'll just say it's somebody else. I'll pick someone randomly. Someone else. So, I'll spin the big wheel. And it's fine. She scores on this. She's a little more introverted than me, because most people are. And she says, somewhat disagree. She scores a two. Am I three times more of whatever in this than she is? No, I don't think so. But we treat it like that, don't we? Oh, they're numbers! We're psychologists, we got numbers! And frankly, they're... Do you see what I'm saying? Like, it's not... Likert scales aren't really ratio scales, right? Remember ratio scales? Like, there's a 0 point? There's no 0 point on those things. Just be careful what I'm saying, please. Experimental variables are great. So if I have A1, A2, B1, B2, and I've actually assigned people, that's great. Even if I have to dummy code it, because there's not going to be any multicollinearity there. They don't overlap. So experimental variables can be great, but you don't usually use regression to explain to do experiments. It's not usually what we're after. Usually this is survey type data, or very often it is. So what we have to do is build a model. So how do you choose what variables to use and which ones not to use? That's really what model building is all about. Remember, with ANOVA, we're saying this is an effect, this is an effect, this is not an effect. With multiple regression, we're making a prediction. We're saying y equals this number plus this number times x1 plus this number times x2 plus this number times x3. Done. So we're building a prediction equation. It's a different kind of outcome. And you usually start with quite a few variables when you do this kind of thing. I told you before about my friend Todd doing this stuff where he was trying to predict people's cigarette smoking without doing a physiological measurement. It's easy to tell. I can tell you how many cigarettes you smoke a day. You have to give me a saliva sample and I have to ship it off to the lab. And that's not very good. So if I'm your doctor, right? And I take a saliva sample, I might have to wait a couple of weeks. Instead, what would be nice if I could say, fill out this questionnaire, it'll take me 5 minutes, and I can tell you accurately how many cigarettes you smoke. Because smokers don't know how many cigarettes they smoke. They underestimate all the time. Right? So it's nice if you, in fact, this is what one of the things Todd did, is he got those measurements, but he also got, so he could get an accurate measurement of how many cigarettes people smoke per day. But he said, I don't want to use those as variables. I now have 22 variables that are all behavioral, that people can answer. And that they are accurate about. Some of them were zeros and ones. They were things like, do you feel nauseous when you have your first cigarette of the day? Yes or no? Could you quit today? Yes or no? So there's some binary variables in there. Others, though. What's the maximum amount of cigarettes you can smoke in a day? What's the minimum amount of cigarettes you can smoke in a day? How old were you started smoking? Questions like that, right? So he started with 22 variables, he got down to 4. And he was able to predict how many cigarettes people smoke per day by asking them maximum cigarettes per day, minimum cigarettes per day, could they quit right now, yes or no, and have you tried to quit before, yes or no. And you can do it as accurately as giving someone a saliva test.
So how would you narrow it down to a saliva variable?
Exactly what we're going to talk about. This is the hard part, because when you get 22 variables, you look and go, well, they don't correlate with a certain number of cigarettes per day.
Because they don't be important in some sense.
They might be. Right? That's the problem. Well, one thing you could do is you could try to do every possible regression model. Okay? And then look at all of them and see if it's a good model. So if we have three variables, x1, x2, x3, we have seven possible models. Right? x1, x2, x3, x1, x2, x1, x3, x2, x3, x1, x2, x3. Okay. With four variables, there are 15 possible models. That's still doable. I can look at 15 different models and I can say, yeah, that's done, that can be done. I can look at the R squareds. Sure. For 10, I don't even know the number. It's lots. And for 22, it crashes computers. It crashes mainframe computers being able to control them. Because I gave students, when I taught this course to graduate students, Mufti, I gave them the data set. I said, just find me a regression model. Please, by the way, don't tell it you want all possible regressions. Because it will just take over the computer. It was like Captain Kirk getting a computer so confused that it started to smoke. Right? Which is about a third of all Star Trek episodes. So, I submit to you that Landry, you are not being good for the body. So this is what happens. I kept getting these phone calls from the computer people saying, can I speak to Professor Brodbeck? It's like, oh, this is great. I'm Professor Brodbeck. I'm a graduate student. If you tell your students that, no, I told them specifically not to do this. So it becomes undoable very quick. So one of the first things you can do is just look at residual plots. Oh, sorry. One of the things you can do is look at residual plots. Make sure that an X variable on its own doesn't have any weird outlier. So it's like it should be all uniform, as many over-predictions, under-prediction. It shouldn't change depending upon how the X changes. There shouldn't be some weird one up here. Todd did find a coding error. He figures it was a coding error. The guy who said he smoked 400 cigarettes a day. Well, that can't be true. That just can't be true. But 40 and someone mistyped, but it's like, well, it's done now. Because that's professional smoking, right? That's like, it's like, go pro. It's really Olympics. I mean, you can find nonlinear relationships. If it underpredicts and overpredicts and underpredicts, it's like, oh, I can't use that variable. That's not a straight line. Not have straight lines. So here's a way to do it. You might think, well, we have computers. Maybe computers can do it for us. So the first thing you do, this is a method called forward selection. Forward selection is one of three automated methods I'll tell you about. You start with the X variable that has the highest R squared with Y. Okay? And you don't do this. The computer does this because these calculations run in nightmare. You then add the next variable that gives the biggest jump in R squared. So what it does is it compares. So if you've got 22 variables, it takes the first one that has the biggest R squared, and then it says, okay, now which one of all the other ones do I throw in next? Keep going until the jump in R squared is not big enough. And you might, the obvious question is, how big is not big enough? Well, you look at something called F star. I never have any notes. I'm telling you how the computer does it. It's mean squared regression for x1 given x2. Oh, that looks like type 2 sum of squares divided by mean squared regression for x1, x2. Is this a significant amount? It's an F test because they're both with variance. And I can tell you a little pro tip. You don't change the defaults. Unless you are an expert, just let the computer do it. But eventually it stops, it goes not significant anymore, I quit. And it spits out a model for you. You go, yeah, here's a model. Or you can do the other backwards elimination. You take all variables, and then you start taking variables out that don't explain a significant amount of variance. Okay? That's another way to do it. Delete variables that contribute the least until F star starts to get significant. You go, stop, no, that's a good model, we're done.
So the smallest F star, then you go back and you take out another one, take out another one. You know what's weird? You would think that backwards elimination and forward selection would give you the same one. So that's weird, and that's because of things like multicollinearity. You're going to have, these automatic things don't look and say, these little variables overlap. They don't care. They just look at type 2 sums of squares, what about type 1 sums of squares? That's all they're doing. What if we combine the two into some wonderful thing called stepwise regression? Which people think is a statistical technique, and it's actually a way to select variables. And it pisses me off when I read the papers. We did a stepwise regression. Now that's not a thing. That's like saying we did an SPSS. It's a technique. It's not an actual statistical. Statistical thing. Starting to sound kind of old. How many pennies tall are you, Sonny? So you combine the two. This sounds great. You go forward. Check F star for each variable. So you start with forward selection. And you drop variables, so you now know, again, the computer is doing this, it's going to check every variable that's been added, and every variable that isn't added, can I now drop one? Because sometimes you put a new one in, it contributes a lot, but it overlaps with another, so it drops one out. So you have a criteria for adding and dropping. And that criterion is F star to enter and F star to leave. And F star to enter has to be greater than F star to leave, or the computer will just add a variable, drop a variable, add a variable, drop a variable, and just gets caught in a loop and it'll never stop. That's something else that back in the old days, when computers did one thing at a time, and someone would screw with the defaults, be like, all of U of T now can't do any computing, because some dummy in Broadbeck's class thought he'd screw with the defaults. That also happened. It's like, I'm sorry, I told you not to do this.
So you don't play with the defaults.
That sounds pretty good. Thing is, none of these things, all they're looking at is apps. All they're looking at is variance accounted for, and that's not the only thing. They are looking at residual plots, C for outliers, for C for weird relationships, curvilinear relationships. They don't care about any of that stuff. In fact, my prof, Dr. Spence, Ian Spence, used to say that the only thing these three different methods, they'll give you a model, it won't be the best one. They'll give you one. So how have I ever done this? Which, I've only really ever done this once, for like an anger. I've done it for projects and stuff, for homework in school, but I haven't done homework all the time. I did this once for a thing when I was trying to make a prediction equation for something a long time ago. So, start with a correlation matrix. This is your first thing. Look at all the variables and you say, okay, I'm going to throw out 20 of them right now. Because so many of them don't correlate enough with why that I care. And it's like, how much is enough? As much as I feel like. I have to do that based on what the other variables correlate. So I pick a subset of them, and I'll do, if possible, if I can say I'm happy with these five variables, I'll probably do all possible regressions. Five gives you it's a number less than 50. You could probably do it. Four would be ideal. That's doable. 15 models, I can look at 15 different regression models. And I can look at their residual plots. Now, if I come down to like I got seven, I'm not doing all possible regressions because I'll be there for the rest of my life, probably literally. So if I had seven, let's say, I'd try all three automatic methods with those seven variables and the Y. I'd do stepwise, I'd do backwards, and I'd do forwards. And I check out, and then when it comes out, if they all agree, I'm going to be pretty happy with that model, but then I'm going to check for outliers, I'm going to check for residual plots. Okay? And then I put it away for 2 weeks, and I come back to it and do it again. Right? Because you might have missed something.
And there's this thing that happens to people, they get married to their ideas. And you think, oh, that must be right. So if I just did it again right now, I'm going to come up with the same thing. And I don't want to come up with the same thing necessarily. I want to put it away and come up with the same thing kind of organically. And that is a way to do it, and it's probably the best way to do it. I can tell you, when I have given students those as a final assignment, say, make the best, find the best model, they all come up with the same one Todd did, the four variable model, because it was the best model, even though they had 22 variables to work with. And they did it basically like this. It's a nightmarish thing to do. It's a horrible task. But it has its uses for pressure. Questions on that? All right, we are done.